The 2012 presidential election. Who's going to win? That's what we're going to talk about this morning. I'm going to tell you from according to the Bible, I'm going to actually tell you who's going to win the election. What are you talking about? I'm going to give you a prophecy this morning of who's going to win based on scripture. So I don't know if you can do that. Well, we'll see about that as we get through the message. I just want to thank everybody out there who prayed for me for my health. Last week my voice was not all there, so I wasn't able to preach. That's the first time since I've been in ministry that that happened. But I guess the Lord decided I needed a week off or something. I was able to get some good work done this week, so because I didn't have to prepare a sermon. But I'm back now. So let's get into the message here this morning. Turn to Ezra. I don't know if I've ever done any kind of preaching from Ezra before. We're going to read a couple verses here. Back in your Old Testament, the book of Ezra comes right before Nehemiah. Some people say that doesn't help much. Ezra chapter 5. Ezra chapter 5, verse 6. So we're going to start out. The Lord tends to repeat things in history, and there's a lot of people, philosophers and such, that have realized that. And one of the great statements is the only thing that men learn from history is that men don't learn from history. And those that fail to learn from history are doomed to repeat it. Those are the kinds of statements that you'll hear concerning history, and they're both very true. And we're going to see today that God did certain things with the nation of Israel, and those same things, that same pattern, will be repeated with any nation out there. So we're going to see that here. Ezra chapter 5, we're going to start at verse 6. Says here, the copy of the letter that Tattenai, governor of on this side the river, and Shethar-Boznai, and his companions, the Apharsachites, which were on this side of the river, sent unto Darius the king. They sent a letter unto him, wherein was written thus, unto Darius the king, all peace. Be it known unto the king that we went into the province of Judea to the house of the great God, which is builded with great stones, and timber is laid in the walls, and this work goeth fast on, and prospereth in their hands. Then asked we those elders, and said unto them thus, Who commanded you to build this house and to make up these walls? We ask their names also to certify thee, that we might write the names of the men that were the chief of them. And thus they returned us answer, saying, We are the servants of the God of heaven and earth, and build the house that was builded these many years ago, which a great king of Israel builded and set up. But after that our fathers had provoked the God of heaven and excuse me, but after that our fathers had provoked the God of heaven unto wrath, he gave them into the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, the Chaldean, who destroyed this house and carried the people away into Babylon. Now, notice a couple things there. Who builded this great house? King Solomon. Now, if you remember a couple sermons ago there, we had the thing about the world's great or the greatest celebrity in history, which was King Solomon. And King Solomon built this amazing temple, this synagogue, whatever you want to call it, to the Lord. But what happened to King Solomon? He married these strange women. They turned away his heart from God to serve these other gods. And what happened? Well, he fell. He was destroyed by the end of his life. And so that's what we see there. So this great king that's talked about here in the book of Ezra, there in verse 11, this great king of Israel built and set up, that's King Solomon. That's who's being spoken about there. And what happened? Well, they lost the temple. Pretty interesting there. But what did God allow to happen to these people? The people of God, this nation, this chosen nation of Israel, what did God allow to happen to them? He allowed them to be taken captive by a pagan ruler. So, in other words, their ruler became a bad guy. They had a great king in King David, and then his son King Solomon was also great. But after that, Israel fell as a nation because they forsook the Lord. Probably getting some of the drift of where I'm going here. Now, who's going to be the next president in America? How about Obama? How'd you like to have four more years of that guy? You know, and you can apply the same stuff here if you live in the UK or if you live in Australia or Germany or wherever else. You know, you can apply the same thing. Your rulers, your leaders are going to be corrupt if your nation is corrupt. Just the way it is. But as far as Obama is concerned, he's the worst president in history. He's racked up more debt. He's passed more unconstitutional legislation. He's not a good ruler. He's a bad ruler. Maybe we'll get him back in there again. What about Romney, Mitt Romney, the billionaire Mormon? You know, I heard a guy say the one time, why does a multi-billionaire want to run for president? Isn't that kind of weird? You know, it'd be like a millionaire saying, I want to go work at McDonald's or something. I mean, you know, the president of the United States doesn't make very much money. Why would a man who's worth billions of dollars want to become a president? Why? Because then he can get all of his deals. Little deals with his corporations that he's tied with and the bankers that he's tied with. They can work everything out. And that's what our government is here in America now. It's big corporate, you know, as Dwight D. Eisenhower warned about, he said about warning about the military-industrial complex taking over America. Well, they took over. And Mitt Romney, a lot of his fortune was made from being tied to a lot of big globalist organizations, Goldman Sachs and things like that. And it's interesting, too, because 1 Timothy 6:10 identifies the love of money as the root of all evil. So when you get a guy who's worth billions of dollars, guess how he got most of that money? Evil. Yeah. What about Newt Gingrich? That guy just looks crooked. You know, I wouldn't trust that guy with anything. I wouldn't trust him handing my wallet and say, I got to go across the street. I wouldn't trust him. You know, and he's been out to Bohemian Grove. He's another globalist. Rick Santorum. There you got a Roman Catholic. Roman Catholic who's been tied in with a lot of other scandals. Not going to get into that. And some people say, what about Ron Paul? What if we would get Ron Paul in there? How long do you think he'd live? You know, I mean, this guy, he wants to go in and he wants to get rid of the Federal Reserve and he wants to reform this and reform that and he wants to get rid of this branch of the government and that, you know. I'm saying crooked branches, you know, lower, you know, no income tax and all this other stuff, which all that stuff's nice, but how long do you think they'd let him get away with that stuff? You know, how long before he would take the same route as JFK did, you know? And then if they would do that, then they could really bring in some tyranny. So what chances do we have as a nation here in America? What are our options? Not too good. And but let me ask you a question. What if God gave us a good president and America became a rich, prosperous nation again? America's still pretty rich, but what if God gave us a good president? What would the American people do with it? What would they do with their peace and prosperity? Would they return to the Lord? No, they wouldn't. It's kind of like, to give you a little analogy here, it'd be kind of like a drunken, you know, some kid comes home and he goes up to his father and he's, you know, he's just staggering around and he says, well, I just wrecked my car and, you know, I wrecked it into the side of a patrol car, you know, and when the state trooper got out, I beat him up and then I went and I got a prostitute out there and, you know, and I think, she's probably with child from me and this and that. And he goes, you know, and I robbed the bank and I was caught with 10 pounds of cocaine and I was this and I was that. And the father goes, oh, wow, that's pretty bad. And this, what do you want? And the son says to his father, he goes, well, I need your checkbook and the keys to your car. And the father goes, oh, okay, sure. That sounds good. Here you go. You say, well, the guy'd be out of his mind. Yeah, it'd be about like God blessing America. America's done all this wickedness and sin and horrible things, abortion, pornography, all kinds of sex perversion. I just saw a thing on Brian Beacon's channel where a 7-year-old boy is trying to get into the Girl Scouts because his parents are dressing him up like a girl. They're trying to say he's a girl. He's really a girl. That's disgusting. And God's going to bless a nation like that? God's just going to say, hey, that's okay, you know. Here's my checkbook. Here's the keys, you know, to the car, like the father analogy. No, God's not going to do that. God cannot bless a nation like America. What's going to happen? Well, we're going to be given over to the king of Babylon. We're going to be given over to a corrupt ruler. That's what's going to happen. You say, who's going to win the presidential election? The wrong man. The wrong one. Whatever's going to be worse for America, that's who's going to get in. I'm going to tell you that. Why? Because God's judgment is on this country. And you look at the solution, you know, the people, the patriots and stuff, they come out and they say, we got to, you know, we got to do this and we got to do that. And what's the solution with most of those people? Well, let's put aside our differences. Let's not fight over religion. I heard one recently in an interview, and this woman, she said that she's a lesbian. And she said, as patriotic Americans, we can't fight over things like sexuality anymore. We have to join together and fight against the globalists. No, we don't. I'm not going to join a bunch of sodomites. I'm not going to join Catholics. I'm not going to join, you know, whoever. I'm not going to join them. I'm going to stick with the Word of God. And the Word of God says destruction is coming. Now, the main purpose of this sermon this morning is to tell you that, yeah, we're going to get a bad leader. And if you are in another country and you're doing the same things as America, like the UK and Australia and things, you're going to get bad leaders too. God's not going to give you good leaders and prosperity. But I want to answer a very false teaching that's based on one verse of Scripture. And I'm going to show you that they are lying to you when somebody quotes this verse of Scripture. And I've heard this thing time and time again, and it just makes me very, very angry. We're going to actually go back in time. We're there in Ezra, where they're coming back into the land trying to rebuild the temple that they lost in the days of King Solomon. Now we're actually going to go back in time before the temple was lost. Turn in your Bible to 2 Chronicles, just a book or two, so I guess it's, yeah, it's one book back. 2 Chronicles chapter 7 and verse 14. And I'm sure all of you out there that have heard this thing, this nice little verse quoted, and, you know, people quote it and they say, well, there's hope for America yet, you know, and I'm going to read it like they would read it. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. America, we can come back. And let me read a verse of Scripture for you. If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves, and pray, and seek my face, and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven, and will forgive their sin, and heal their land. Can't even read it right. Do you ever hear that? You ever hear some guy standing up there and saying, oh, if my people would humble themselves, you know, and they go through the whole thing and they make you think that that's for today. They make you think that this is for America and this applies just across the board. I'm going to show you that that's not true. What's the context? A text without a context is a pretext. Remember that. Somebody just quotes one verse of Scripture, especially when they go back to the Old Testament and they just pull one verse of Scripture out and they say, see, America, if we would but humble ourselves and turn from our sin and everything else, you know, then God will heal us and cleanse our land. That's not true. Okay, especially even if prophecy wasn't being fulfilled right now with the end times and the coming time of Jacob's trouble, even if that, you know, was far off in the future, this still doesn't apply to America. And I'm going to show you why. Let's look at the context here. Go to verse 1. 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 1. Now when Solomon had made an end of praying, the fire came down from heaven and consumed the burnt offerings and the sacrifices, and the glory of the Lord filled the house. And the priests could not enter into the house of the Lord because the glory of the Lord had filled the Lord's house. And when all the children of Israel saw how the fire came down and the glory of the Lord upon the house, they bowed themselves with their faces to the ground upon the pavement, and worshipped and praised the Lord, saying, for he is good, for his mercy endureth forever. Can we do that today? Do we have a priesthood with burnt offerings and sacrifices? No. But let's just say, well, we'll just make that into prayer and repentance or something, we'll say. Could you see Americans doing that? Everybody bowing down before the Lord. You know, the Bible talks there about the pavement. Put their faces to the ground upon the pavement. Get out there and see everybody with their face right on the ground, praying to the Lord, worshiping God. Get real. Verse 4. Then the king and all the people offered sacrifices before the Lord. Now look at this, verse 5. And King Solomon offered a sacrifice of 22,000 oxen and 120,000 sheep. So the king and all the people dedicated the house of God. Now, here we have the king, who in context is King Solomon, and he offers this tremendous sacrifice to the Lord. Now, I did a little bit of research here, and this isn't exact numbers, you know. I'm sure that this it changes the stock market, or the stock prices change, you know, from time to time. But this will give you just a general idea of what kind of money we're talking about here. I had to look this up. I'm not big on cattle and sheep prices. I don't usually keep track of that. But there was an article, Key Beef Cattle Marketing Concepts. And they say here that if the market price is $70 per 100 weight, a 1,200-pound steer would bring $840. Okay? So that's the way I figured it there. Now, you know, I'm sure that there are people out there in the cattle industry that would probably say, actually, it's more or a little bit less, whatever. This is a fairly recent number here. We're going to go with this thing of $840. Now, the Bible says there that he sacrificed 22,000 oxen. Now, the word oxen is just a word for cattle that work. Okay, a working cattle, a bull or a steer that works, is they call it an oxen. All right, it's not some different species of animal or something. So you have there, the price is $840 per oxen, is what we're figuring there. About a 1,200-pound steer would bring $840. Solomon sacrificed how many? 22,000. All right, so you take 22,000 times 840, you come up with 18,480,000. So almost $18.5 million worth of cattle is what King Solomon sacrificed. But that isn't it. He also sacrificed 120,000 sheep. Now what do they bring? Well, again, I looked up some numbers here, and on average they were saying that a good sheep, which you have to sacrifice a good sheep, if you read back through the Old Testament, they were supposed to sacrifice them without blemish. So they were sacrificing the finest sheep. So a good one today would be about $150. All right, so 120,000 sheep times $150 each would bring you to $18 million. So in other words, Solomon sacrificed $36,480,000 worth of animals to God before God said he would forgive them. Not only were these people praying, falling down before the Lord, putting their face on the pavement, praying and worshiping God, but Solomon also sacrificed $36.5 million worth of livestock to the Lord before God said he would forgive their sin. I wonder how they missed that. These guys out there that quote 2 Chronicles 7:14 for America, just like we can just start right now and just God will forgive us. You know, let's get praying, Christians. We'll pray and God will forgive our land. How did you miss the $36.5 million worth of livestock that was sacrificed before verse 14 is spoken? See? Be very careful when you have preachers and teachers quoting one verse of Scripture out of the Old Testament and saying it applies to us today. Be very careful. That's why it's so important to rightly divide the word of truth. We're dealing with a totally different world back here. A totally different system. This does not apply. 2 Chronicles 7:14 does not apply to today. Now let's look at verse 6 here in 2 Chronicles chapter 7. And the priests waited on their offices, the Levites also with instruments of music of the Lord, which David the king had made to praise the Lord, because his mercy endureth forever. When David praised by their ministry, and the priests sounded trumpets before them, and all Israel stood. Moreover, Solomon hallowed the middle of the court that was before the house of the Lord, for there he offered burnt offerings and the fat of the peace offerings, because the brazen altar which Solomon had made was not able to receive the burnt offerings and the meat offerings and the fat. Well, I guess not. When you have 22,000 oxen, you're going to need a pretty big altar to do all that sacrificing. I mean, that's pretty incredible right there. But one other question here again. Is this possible for us today in the church age? Do we have the tribe of the Levites as our priesthood? You say, well, no, of course not. Then why are you applying verse 14 to Christians today? Doesn't work. Verse 8. Also at the same time, Solomon kept the feast 7 days, and all Israel with him, a very great congregation from the entering in of Hamath unto the river of Egypt. And in the 8th day they made a solemn assembly, for they kept the dedication of the altar 7 days, and the feast 7 days. And on the 23rd day of the 17th month, he sent the people away into their tents, glad and merry in heart for the goodness that the Lord had showed unto David and to Solomon and to Israel his people. What did it say there in verse 14? If my people? How do you reconcile this stuff? Verse 11. Thus Solomon finished the house of the Lord and the king's house, and all that came into Solomon's heart to make in the house of the Lord and in his own house, he prosperously effected. Who's the verse talking about? Who are these verses talking about? It's talking about Israel. This is not for Gentile nations in the body of Christ. It's just ridiculous. Verse 12. I'm going to read down through here. And the Lord appeared to Solomon by night, and said unto him, I have heard thy prayer, and have chosen this place to myself for an house of sacrifice. If I shut up heaven that there be no rain, or if I command the locusts to devour the land, or if I send pestilence among my people, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. Now mine eyes shall be opened, that mine ears attend unto the prayer that is made in this place. For now have I chosen and sanctified this house, that my name may be there forever, and mine eyes and mine heart shall be there perpetually. And as for thee, if thou wilt walk before me, as David thy father walked, and do according to all that I have commanded thee, and shalt observe my statutes and my judgments, then will I establish the throne of thy kingdom according as I have covenanted with David thy father, saying, there shall not fail thee a man to be ruler in Israel. But if ye turn away and forsake my statutes and my commandments, which I have set before you, and shall go and serve other gods and worship them, then will I pluck them up by the roots out of my land which I have given them, and this house which I have sanctified for my name will I cast out of my sight, and will make it to be a proverb and a byword among all nations. And this house which is high shall be an astonishment to every one that passeth by it, so that he shall say, why hath the Lord done thus unto this land and unto this house? And it shall be answered, because they forsook the Lord God of their fathers, which brought them forth out of the land of Egypt, and laid hold on other gods, and worshipped them, and served them. Therefore hath he brought all this evil upon them. Let me ask you a question. Did the Jews and King Solomon as their leader, did they follow verse 14? No. Did they forsake the Lord? Yes. Did they turn to other gods? Yes. Did God bring evil upon them as a result? Yes. So even verse 14, 2 Chronicles 7:14, even to those that it was spoken to, they couldn't fulfill it. They didn't fulfill it. So even in context, if you even want to take this and talk about the ancient nation of Israel, they didn't keep it. They did not do it. They did not submit to it. So why would you try and use it for today? Why would you try and put that down for the body of Christ, the Gentile nation, Gentile nations, and some Jews as well? But why would you put that down for us today if they couldn't even do it back then? You see? You see what a lot of these false preachers are doing? I've come up with a new term for the modern church. The modern church is corporate socialism. And it is. The modern churches are corporations. They run them like a business. They do events to get more people in. And the ministry, quote unquote, that they do is socialism. Raking leaves for elderly people, getting clothes to the sick, feeding the hungry, it's all that stuff. It's socialism. It's social gospel that they preach. Do nice things for other people. Well, doing nice things is all right. I'm not against that. I have brethren that do that kind of thing. But you better be preaching the gospel too. And the gospel is offensive to people. The gospel is going to drive people away. You know? And how many people really do you think in America would even follow 2 Chronicles 7:14 if it was for us today? I mean, humble themselves? What happened after 9/11? I saw these cars going around with America, the power of pride they had on the back. I'm proud to be an American. Really? Bible says humble yourself. They're not going to do that. How about pray? God's not interested in the prayers of the wicked. He doesn't even hear them. Seek my face. How many people really truly sought the Lord after the last big tragedy of 9/11? Very few. Here you go. Turn from their wicked ways. You go to these sodomites and you say, you better turn from your wicked ways. They want to put you in prison for that now. They say it's a hate crime. You know. They're not going to turn from their wicked ways. They have no intention of it. And God's not going to hear from heaven, and he will not forgive the sins of America, and he's not going to heal this land. It's not going to happen. What's going to happen? Therefore hath he brought all this evil upon them. Evil's going to come to America. Who's going to win the election? Whoever's going to do the most evil to America. America has to be punished. I'm real sorry, but that's the way it is. And I'm going to show you a couple other things here. As we continue in this study, we're going to talk next about post-millennialism versus pre-millennialism. And there's a lot of believers that are going over to this post-millennial type of philosophy. And these are the types of people that are going to quote 2 Chronicles 7:14. They're going to lie to you and tell you that America is going to be all right. Post-millennialism. This is a belief where Christians bring in world peace through non-violent means, and Jesus returns at the end of this wonderful time to see what a good job we've done. That's the belief of post-millennialism, which is, I'm sorry, there's no nice way for me to put this, it's idiotic. You have to be substandard in your intelligence, in your IQ, to believe that man can bring in 1,000 years of peace without Jesus Christ. It's ridiculous. Absolutely absurd. Man has never been able to rule any kingdom here on earth for 1,000 years. I think the average age of great nations is about 250. 250 years and then they fall apart. And you might want to check the amount of years that America has been around. We're getting close to falling apart. No nation in history has ever been in debt as much as America. America is going to crash and burn very soon. Hopefully the rapture will happen first. I'd rather not be here for it. Can't guarantee it though. Now, what does the Bible say? Turn to Romans chapter 11. We're going to see this thing about this whole deal of God's nation will be God's nation and my people and all this stuff. This is based on a lie called replacement theology. I could do a whole lot of studies on this. Replacement theology came around, you know, the first century Christians were mostly Jews. And as time went by, there were more and more Gentiles. And a lot of the early church fathers that you hear about and things, a lot of them were Gentiles, and they started to come up with this thing of replacement theology, that now the church has replaced Israel. That's not true. And post-millennialism is a belief that the church has replaced Israel, which is ridiculous. Romans chapter 11, verse 1. I say then, hath God cast away his people? God forbid, for I also am an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. God hath not cast away his people which he foreknew. Wot ye not what the scripture saith of Elias, how he maketh intercession to God against Israel, saying, Lord, they have killed thy prophets and digged down thine altars, and I am left alone, and they seek my life. Well, what saith the answer of God unto him? I have reserved to myself 7,000 men who have not bowed the knee to the image of Baal. Even so then, at this present time also there is a remnant according to the election of grace. Not all Jews are evil. Okay, you get this whole thing, these people that are anti-Zionist, you know, how dare you stand for Jews and the nation of Israel, they're wicked and all this other stuff. Don't fall for that. And don't fall for this stuff either, these people, you know, I'm a Jew now, you know, I'm a Hebrew, I'm a Messianic Jew. No, you're not. You know, don't fall for that whole Messianic Jew movement either. You get these people, you know, white and black people walking around saying that they're Jews now. I mean, it's ridiculous. Don't fall for that. And you say, well, it's spiritual Jews. No, it isn't. Verse 1 there, Paul says he's an Israelite of the seed of Abraham, of the tribe of Benjamin. He's talking about flesh. And he talks later on about how, you know, Jews according to the flesh. He's not talking about spiritual Jews, you know, adopted in to the promises, you know, receiving the promises from Abraham and all that. Paul's not talking about that. He's talking about physical Jews here. And don't fall for this thing that they're all bad now somehow. Jump down to verse 11. It says here, I say then, have they stumbled that they should fall? God forbid, but rather through their fall, salvation has come unto the Gentiles for to provoke them to jealousy. Now if the fall of them be the riches of the world and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness? For I speak to you Gentiles, inasmuch as I am the apostle of the Gentiles, I magnify mine office. If by any means I may provoke to them, or to emulation, them which are my flesh. There you see it. Paul's talking about Jews, physical Jews, not spiritual Jews, and might save some of them. For if the casting away of them be the reconciling of the world, what shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead? We Gentile Christians are very fortunate. Okay, we were not part of God's original plan. Now you say, well, you mean God didn't know? Well, God knew, but he had to offer the kingdom first to the Jewish people, to the people of Israel. Jesus Christ came as their king, as their promised Messiah, and they rejected him. And so he died on the cross. The Jews were the ones that put him to death. They killed their king. And then, even after he came back from the dead, he went and he gave signs and wonders to the apostles to go in there and convert the Jewish people. A lot of them were converted, but still, as a nation, they still rejected Jesus Christ as their king. So at that point in time, salvation came to the Gentile people, to us. And there again, 2 Chronicles 7:14, God's speaking to Israel. He wasn't speaking to the ancient Germanic people or the ancient British people, or he wasn't speaking to the ancient descendants of Japheth or to the ancient descendants of Ham. He was speaking to the Jews. That's what was going on in 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14. Don't apply that to us today. It doesn't work. And here, the Lord's saying, you better be careful speaking against the Jewish people. Let's continue on here. Verse 16. For if the first fruit be holy, the lump is also holy, and if the root be holy, so are the branches. And if some of the branches be broken off, and thou, being a wild olive tree, wert grafted in among them, and with them partakest of the root and fatness of the olive tree, boast not against the branches, but if thou boast, thou bearest not the root, but the root thee. Thou wilt say then, the branches were broken off, that I might be grafted in. Well, because of unbelief they were broken off, and thou standest by faith. Be not high-minded, but fear. You say, what on earth is this all about? Well, what's going on there is this tree, you know, they talk about a family tree. This olive tree that the Bible's talking about there is a type of Israel. And the Lord is saying, what's going on here is these natural branches, the Jewish people, as a nation, they rejected Jesus Christ, so the Lord broke them off. A Jew right now, even though they're still God's chosen people, even though God has not cast them away, if a Jew lives and dies without Jesus Christ, they go to hell. You don't, just being a Jew, according to the flesh, doesn't give you an automatic ticket to heaven. You still have to go to heaven through Jesus Christ. So right now, the Jews, the nation of Israel, it's not God's nation right now, but they will be. And that's where a lot of people make a mistake. They'll point to the sin and the wickedness. I heard that prostitution is legal in Jerusalem, in Israel. You know, male and female prostitution. You know, sodomy is very rampant over there in Jerusalem right now. The Jews are very, very wicked people at this point. And they, as a nation, they've rejected Jesus Christ. Now that's going to change in the time of Jacob's trouble. But right now, God's attention, his focus is on the Gentile nations. God's no respecter of persons right now. That'll change at the rapture. The rapture is what ends the church age. That's the cutting off there. And so what the Lord's saying right here is he's saying, hey, even though those Jews are bad, even though those Jews are in sin, even though that they have rejected Jesus Christ, boast not thyself against Israel. Don't mock Israel and mock the Jews and try to say that, you know, we're now the Jews or something like that. Don't do that. We're not to boast against that olive tree. And we're grafted into that olive tree. We are heirs according to the promise. We are Abraham's seed in that we are adopted into it. But don't boast against that tree. We're going to see what happens here. Notice verse 20 there. We just read this, but it says, be not high-minded, but fear. Now look at verse 21. For if God spared not the natural branches, take heed lest he also spare not thee. In other words, if God said to Israel, you remember there we read in the very beginning of this message back in Ezra? What do we read? We read that God gave the Jewish people over into the hand of the king of Babylon, King Nebuchadnezzar. And he did all sorts of horrible things. You can read about that in the book of Daniel. He was a pagan. We are supposed to take heed as Gentile nations. We aren't supposed to say, well, we got it figured out, you know, and we won't ever have things happen to us like God put Israel through back in the Old Testament. We're supposed to fear, and we're to take heed, lest he also spare not thee, lest he also spare not us. And if you want to see what's going to happen to America, go back to the book of Jeremiah and read through to the book of Daniel. And it's like reading a newspaper. We were talking about that this morning. It's like reading a newspaper. The way the people were, the way the people reacted to God. Just heard this past week that Alaska Airlines, they had these little prayer cards that they would give out with their meals. And they're saying that they're going to remove them now because they got too many complaints. And the number one complaint was religion, flying and stuff, air flight is no place for religion. But I bet they'd think differently if the plane was going to crash. I bet you there'd be an awful lot of praying people in there, including atheists. If they knew we're headed for the ground, you know, the plane's going down, and they knew we're going to be crashing, I bet you those atheists would be praying up a storm. You know, God help us, God help us. Yeah, you need him now. And that's funny because that's how America is. Oh, don't tell me about your God. And all of a sudden, tornadoes come through and wreck the place. Hurricane comes through and wreck the place. And then they start talking about God. That's an act of God, you know. Now you want to talk about him. But you see, what's going to happen here to America with this next election, with anything that we have going on, as long as America continues in the path it's going, and it will, I don't have any hope for this country. This country's gone. But as long as this country continues, we're going to see more and more wickedness. And God is going to give us over into the hand of corrupt leaders, of corrupt politicians. You say, well, that's not very positive. The truth is often very negative. I believe in the power of negative thinking. Continuing here, let's look at verse 22. Behold, therefore, the goodness and severity of God on them which fell severity, but toward thee goodness. If, notice there a little qualifier there, if thou continue in his goodness, otherwise thou also shalt be cut off. And they also, if they abide not still in unbelief, shall be grafted in, for God is able to graft them in again. For if thou wert cut out of the olive tree which is wild by nature, and wert grafted contrary to nature into a good olive tree, how much more shall these which be the natural branches be grafted into their own olive tree? For I would not, brethren, that ye should be ignorant of this mystery, that lest ye should be wise in your own conceits, that blindness in part is happened to Israel, until the fullness of the Gentiles become in. And so all Israel shall be saved, as it is written, there shall come out of Zion the Deliverer, and shall turn away ungodliness from Jacob. Isn't that interesting? Well, let's go to verse 27. For this is my covenant unto them, when I shall take away their sins. When's that going to happen? This is prophecy right here. When's this stuff going to happen? When Jesus Christ comes back at the second coming. That's the time when the fullness of the Gentiles is going to be complete. Now, the fullness of the Gentiles is really going to get shortened when you have the rapture. But Gentile rule over this world will continue up until the end of the tribulation. And then Jesus Christ comes back and he sets up his throne in Jerusalem. And you have the judgment of the nations. We as his saints go out and we gather all the nations together and bring them to Jerusalem to be judged. And at that point, Gentile rule ends. The fullness of the Gentiles is, it's done. No longer will you have Gentile rulers on this earth. You will have Jesus Christ ruling and reigning. And then Israel will be saved at that point in time. All right? This hasn't happened yet. It's not symbolic. It's not figurative. This is going to be literal in the future. Now, should we defend everything that the Jews do today? You say, well, they're God's chosen people, so we should just be for everything. No, I didn't say that either. Look at verse 28. As concerning the gospel, they are enemies for your sakes, but as touching the election, they are beloved for the Father's sakes. For the gifts and calling of God are without repentance. For as ye in times past have not believed God, yet have now obtained mercy through their unbelief, even so have these also now not believed, that through your mercy they also may obtain mercy. For God hath concluded them all in unbelief, that he might have mercy upon all. O the depth of the riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, and his ways past finding out. For who hath known the mind of the Lord, or who hath been his counselor? Or who hath first given to him, and it shall be recompensed unto him again? For of him, and through him, and to him are all things, to whom be glory for ever and ever. Amen. You say, what's all that stuff mean? Well, I'll just make it real simple for you. God knows what he's doing. You don't. You can't figure out his mind. Just trust the Lord. As a trusting child would his father. You don't need to understand everything God's going to do. Right now, the Jews are your enemies according to the gospel. If you want to get yelled at and spit on, go over and try preaching Jesus Christ to Orthodox Jews. Okay? You're not going to make too many friends in Jerusalem right now. All right? They are your enemies according to the gospel right now. In the future, they will be saved. The time of Jacob's trouble is going to be, you're going to have signs and wonders proving the New Testament, the validity of the New Testament. You're going to have the two witnesses, Moses and Elijah, coming back to preach to the Jews. And I did a study on that, the doctrine of salvation and tribulation. And the Jews, an Orthodox Jew, they respect Moses more than anybody. And if they had to pick a second guy that they would respect, it'd be Elijah. So what a wonderful plan the Lord has to bring those two men back and have them there performing signs and wonders for 3.5 years. You can read that about that back in Revelation. I think it's chapter 11. But that's going to be God's plan. Right now, God's dealing with the Gentile people, with us as Gentiles. He's dealing with us. But in the future, it's going to be going back to the Jewish people. And I don't mean spiritual Jews or, you know, this replacement theology lie. I mean physical Jews, the people in Israel right now. Now, we talked about post-millennialism, that people believe that Christians can bring in a kingdom without Jesus Christ being physically here. But the post-trib rapture belief is also, they also steal promises from Israel. They also steal from the Jews. they take away the identity of Israel. It's now the Great Tribulation, which the Bible never actually uses that term. It says there shall be Great Tribulation. But no, the Great Tribulation is not a Bible term. The term is the time of Jacob's trouble. Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7. I've talked about that in other studies. So they take away the time of Jacob's trouble. They say it's the church has to suffer for 7 years. We have to be martyred. We have to, you know, suffer. No, it's for the Jews. But they also take away the identity of the Jews as a racial people. You know, the Jews are a race. God is for the thing of races. Okay, it's kind of a Orwellian term now. They say, are you a racist? Well, I acknowledge that there are different races and that God has different plans for different races. Oh, you're a racist then. Why is that a bad thing? I'm not a racial supremacist. You know, I believe God has a chosen race, the Jewish people, but I don't believe that one race is better than another and you should look down on somebody just because they're of a different race. I don't believe that, but I do acknowledge that God has different races in his plan. Sure, absolutely. You know, and the Jews are a racial people. They're not spiritual. Right? That's the distinction that needs to be made there. That's what's going on in Romans chapter 11. And the post-trib rapture people will also try to steal the kingdom of Jesus, which is headquartered in Jerusalem. A lot of times they don't believe in that either. Now, what about premillennialism? Well, that's what the Bible teaches. That's the true Bible position. And that is that the time of the Gentiles is pretty much over with the pre-trib rapture. They still go on for seven more years, the time of Jacob's trouble, and then that's it. And God, once again, is going to deal with the nation of Israel. And Jesus is the one that will judge the earth, and he fixes things up for the millennium, which he rules. That's what premillennialism teaches. So now we're going to hit just a few more verses, and then we're going to be done for this morning. So the question comes up, what should a Christian do from now until the rapture? All right, that's the next big event on God's prophetic timetable is the rapture, the redemption of the purchased possession. All right, what should you do as a Christian from now till then? 1 Timothy chapter 2. Turn in your Bible to 1 Timothy chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. We're going to read that. We're going to see what God's plan is for you. And this is specifically, there's a lot of other instructions I could give you, but this is specifically in relation to the upcoming election. A lot of people kind of get all excited and they, you know, watch the debates and all this stuff back and forth. And, you know, I'm not going to get all tied up in the thing, but it's very obvious that the debates are controlled. These caucuses and stuff that they're voting, this guy and this Mitt Romney won this state, Newt Gingrich won that state. There's so much fraud involved in that. I mean, give me a break. Ron Paul, they're barely giving him any time to talk. He's not winning any states. I mean, it's controlled. Give me a break. But what should we do? What should our hope be for the leaders, the rulers of this country, knowing that there are going to be bad ones coming? 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 1. I exhort, therefore, that first of all, supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men. You say for all men? Yep, let's look at verse 2. For kings and for all that are in authority, that they may live a prosperous life. Is that what it says? No. That we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and honesty. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who will have all men to be saved and to come unto the knowledge of the truth. In plainer words, God's desire for us as Christians in the political realm, the political spectrum, is that they should stay so busy with their thing there that we as Christians can lead a quiet and peaceable life in all honesty. In other words, we don't have to try and lie and try and cover up and try to do the underground house church type of thing because Christians are being persecuted. The way we're living right now in America and the way the brethren are living over in UK and a lot of the other countries that I've had contact with, yes, our politicians are corrupt, but for the most part, we can still live a pretty peaceable life. And I pray that that continues. And we should pray to that end. even though, yes, there's going to be a worse leader coming, we should pray that the Lord gives them guys enough stuff that they can stay busy and stay off of our backs as Christians. We need to be able to keep the doors open long enough to win those last few souls that are going to be added to the body of Christ before we leave. All right? That should be our prayer. Even though, I mean, I'm sorry to burst your bubble if you're really hoping for a good president to come. We're not going to get a good president. Well, you say, well, then we shouldn't pray. No, we should continue to pray for him. You should pray for Obama. All right? Not that God blesses him or something like that. You don't bless somebody who's wicked, but that God keeps Obama and his cronies busy enough that they can stay off of our backs. That's what you should pray for as a Christian. You should pray that God gives them enough to worry about that we can lead a quiet and peaceable life. That's the way it should be. So pray for our leaders. Turn to 2 Peter. 2 Peter chapter 2. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 6 through 9. This nation here in America is just getting more and more wicked. The things that I hear on a weekly basis now, it's just, oh man, it's bad. And I'm going to show you here that this is exactly the way it is before God's nation or God's wrath is poured out on a nation. 2 Peter chapter 2, verse 6. And turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemn them with an overthrow, making them an ensample unto those that after should live ungodly, and deliver just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked. For that righteous man dwelling among them in seeing and hearing vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. The Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. Isn't that interesting? Let me ask you a question. Are you vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked? Are you vexed by the unlawful deeds of the wicked from day to day? Yeah. You say, well, God's wrath is going to come out on the just and on the unjust. God's going to pour out his wrath on everybody, no exceptions. Is that what it says there? Verse 9, the Lord knoweth how to deliver the godly out of temptations and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. God is a just God. God is not about to pour out his wrath and his judgment on people that aren't doing anything wrong. And I'm not saying Christians are perfect, but I'm just saying if you're living as a Christian and you're not guilty of sodomy and all this other wickedness that's in America right now, and sodomy was the sin that was going on there in Sodom and Gomorrah, if you're living a righteous life, God's not going to pour out his judgment on you the same as he will on the sodomites, on the wicked. God knows how to deliver the godly out of temptation and to reserve the unjust unto the day of judgment to be punished. There's coming that separation very soon. I talked about that in my pre-trib rapture judgment sermon I just did not too long ago. God is not going to pour out his wrath and his judgment on people that are just, that are doing the right thing. But now we're going to go back to one other place, and then we're going to be done. Leviticus chapter 19. We're going to go back to the story of Lot. What actually happened back there in the Old Testament. Leviticus chapter 19, verse 12. We're going to see some of the situation there in Sodom and Gomorrah and compare it to today. Leviticus 19, verse 12. And ye shall not swear by my name falsely, neither shalt thou profane the name of thy God, and I am the Lord. Thou shalt not defraud. Am I in the right place here? Thou shalt not defraud thy neighbor, neither rob him. The wages of him that is hired shall not abide with thee all night unto the morning. Thou shalt not curse the deaf, nor put a stumbling block before the blind. You know what? I think I have the wrong... You know what? I wrote Leviticus 19. I meant Genesis 19. I'm sorry. The things there in Leviticus are good too, but... Genesis chapter 19. Why did I write Leviticus? Genesis chapter 19, verse 12. Again, you see how I like to keep proving that I'm not infallible. Genesis chapter 19, verse 12. And the men said unto Lot, the men there being the angels that came to him, hast thou here any besides, son-in-law, and thy sons, and thy daughters, and whatsoever thou hast in the city, bring them out of this place, for we will destroy this place, because the cry of them is waxen great before the face of the Lord, and the Lord hath sent us to destroy it. And Lot went out and spake unto his sons-in-law, which married his daughters, and said, Up, get you out of this place, for the Lord will destroy this city. But he seemed as one that mocked unto his sons-in-law. Isn't that something? How many of you have had that same situation? Man, I'm telling you, the rapture is going to come. God's judgment is going to come on this nation. God's judgment is coming on America. God's judgment is coming on the UK. And people look at you and they go, yeah, you know, I've heard that stuff before. Yeah, whatever, you know. Ha, 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 ha. Yep. That's the condition right before God's judgment. Why? The people's hearts have become hardened. And right now, people are doing the same exact thing. They're saying, God's not going to judge me. I'll do what I want to do, and you won't tell me any different. It's exactly what the people are doing. And you get a Christian come along and you say, and they're trying to warn them and say, you better get saved. The rapture's coming soon. People go, oh, yeah, you know, whatever. Weirdo. Yeah, it's right there. Look at verse 15. And when the morning arose, then the angels hastened Lot, saying, Arise, take thy wife and thy two daughters, which are here, lest thou be consumed in the iniquity of the city. And while he lingered, the men laid hold upon his hand, and upon the hand of his wife, and upon the hand of his two daughters, the Lord being merciful unto him, and they brought him forth and set him without the city. Lot was forcibly removed from the city before God's wrath could be poured out. Now you need to get a hold of that. You know, there's a lot of Christians right now that don't want to leave the city. A lot of them that are saying, oh, I don't think America's so bad. I don't, you know, it's been bad before. You know, I've heard the thing of the rapture before. They're like Lot. They're tarrying. They're going, oh, let's see. What should I take with me? I'd really like to take this. I can't forget that. And the angel comes and he goes and grabs him and says, come on, we're leaving. It wasn't probably the angel put his arm around Lot and his wife and daughters and said, now let's go. No. He put their hands on him and said, come on, we're going. And that's what's going to happen at the rapture. There's going to be an awful lot of Christians that are holding on to this world, and the Lord's going to say, come up hither. And away you go. Oh, I don't know if I was really ready to go. You know, one of the rewards that's given by the judgment seat of Christ is a crown is given to those that love his appearing. You say, well, that seems awfully easy to get that crown. Oh, no, it isn't. Let me ask you a question. Are you really truly looking for the appearing of Jesus Christ? I know a lot of you are, a lot of my listeners are, you know, because I talk about the rapture so much. But you talk to the average Christian, they're not looking for Jesus. He's not in all their thoughts. They're not saying, I really want Jesus to come back. You talk to a lot of Christians out there, they'll say, you say, man, I think the rapture's coming soon. And they'll go, boy, I hope not. What a tragic thing to say. And I'm sure that must break the Lord's heart. I mean, you know, it'd be like the Lord comes and he's getting ready to knock on the door to come to your house and he's going to invite you to his place and he's got a big party planned and all kinds of great stuff. And he goes to knock on the door and he hears something inside and he listens and somebody says, oh, Jesus guy, he's a nice guy, but I really don't want to go to his house. I really don't want to be around him. Boy, I hope he doesn't come and ask us to come to be with him. Man, you think that would hurt the Lord's feelings? His bride that's supposed to be longing to be with him? Oh, I'd rather not. And yet that's how a lot of Christians feel right now. Why? Because their priorities are wrong. They're like Lot. They don't want to leave. They don't want to leave the city. Verse 24. Then the Lord rained upon Sodom and upon Gomorrah brimstone and fire from the Lord out of heaven. And he overthrew those cities and all the plain and all the inhabitants of the cities, and that which grew upon the ground. You know what's going to happen to America and to the UK and to Australia? Just go down through the countries. You know what's going to happen when the body of Christ leaves? No more restraint. The body of Christ is leaving, and the Holy Spirit indwelling in the bodies of believers is going to leave. Now, the Holy Spirit's omnipresent. I understand that. But that restraining force that's here right now, the Bible says about he who now letteth will let until he be taken out of the way. That restraint that's on this world. The wicked, lost world out there, they know. They put up some billboard about sodomy or something in certain areas of the country. They know Christians are going to protest it. They know Christians are going to protest gambling and strip clubs and whatever else. But guess what happens when the body of Christ leaves? That restraint's gone. And guess what God's wrath is going to be like then? It's going to be bad. Very, very bad. I think I used this analogy in another sermon, but I'm just going to use it one more time. In conclusion here, there is a flight that's going to be leaving. I don't know when. I'm hoping this year. I don't know for sure. I think 2012 will be a good year for the rapture. Hopefully it'll be this year. You know, I am looking forward to going to be with all of my friends out there, people that contact me and people that write to me. All our problems are over. I mean, I get people writing and they tell me of their problems, and it's just like, I can't do anything to help a lot of these people. All I can say is just go to the Bible, pray. You know, the Lord will work things out for you. Romans 8:28. There are some suffering Christians. Some real suffering Christians. Christians that have been through some hard times. What's the solution? What's the hope that I can give them? The Bible calls it the blessed hope. That's the rapture. The redemption of the purchased possession. I mean, if you imagine you're on an aircraft carrier, we'll say, and you look and it's starting to go down and starting to sink, and there's shark-infested waters, you know, and it's getting bad, and you look and the engine room's on fire and everything's falling apart, and there's people back there, most of the crew's fighting and killing each other and, you know, all this bad stuff, and there's one airplane left, and it's going to be taken off soon. Would you say, I don't really care about that airplane? No. You'd be saying, what do I need to do to get a ticket? Well, there's a flight that's going to be leaving soon. Jesus Christ is going to be coming and redeeming his purchased possession before his judgment comes, like he's done every single time throughout the Bible. Every single time that people's hearts are hardened, the Lord says, I'm going to remove the just, and then my wrath is going to come upon the wicked. And right now, that time is very close. Very, very close. So right now, the flight's boarding. And there are still some seats left. Now, if you're listening to this sermon, you're probably, a lot of people are saved that listen to my sermons. I know that. But if you're somehow, you're lost and you're listening to this thing, or if you have lost relatives or lost friends or family, the flight's about ready to take off. There's not much time left. And those few remaining seats are going to fill up quick. You know, so in conclusion here, I'll say this. Don't pray for the election, because God can't restore peace and prosperity to this wicked nation. Who's going to win the 2012 presidential election? Well, if the body of Christ is still around, if we still have to stay here for another year, I'll tell you who's going to win it. The wrong person. No matter who gets in there, this nation is going to continue to fall apart. Because this nation has turned its back on God. This nation serves other gods. Our hope, our only hope, our blessed hope, is to be with Jesus. For him to come and put an end to this rotten mess. And to take us to be with him. And what a glorious reunion it's going to be. You know, that should be at the forefront of what you want. You know, they say, if you could have one wish, what would it be? Well, if you're right with the Lord, I'll tell you right now what your wish should be. It should be that Jesus Christ comes back. Not, oh, I wish I could have $1 million, or I wish I could have a big house, or I wish I could have this or that. Uh-uh. I mean, you know, think about it. If you got $1 million in a big house, well, you just have to worry about people stealing it then. You know, a couple years down the road, you'd have to paint it. You'd have to put a new roof on. You'd have to have the plumbing fixed. You'd have to get the, you know, Don't wish for things. Don't lust after things here on this earth. Set your affections on things above. Right? That's what we should be concerned with. Don't get caught up in this presidential election stuff. Don't get your hopes up. Don't start thinking, oh, I think we can go back. And don't fall for 2 Chronicles 7:14. That verse is completely ripped out of context by false teachers. And there again, go back to the book of Jeremiah. And you'll see that the priests are bearing rule by their means, and they tell people what they want to hear. It's all lining up. Why? Well, because the wild branches that were grafted into the natural olive tree, us Gentile nations, we're not taking heed to the things that God wrote about there in the Old Testament. We're not taking heed to what happened and why the Jews fell, and we're going to follow the exact same path. So what's the hope for the 2012 presidential election? Nothing. We're just going to get a worse president. So that's going to be it for this morning. Nice positive message for you. Look for Jesus Christ. Pray for Jesus Christ to come back. One other thing here quick before we close this sermon. Our hymn for this morning is number 524, He Hideth My Soul. I just wanted to read the last verse of it. It says, this is by Fanny Crosby, the great hymn writer, and it says here, when clothed in his brightness, transported I rise to meet him in clouds of the sky. His perfect salvation, his wonderful love, I'll shout with the millions on high. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of his love and covers me there with his hand. Just a wonderful reminder that the Lord does hide us and protect us, and that he will shelter us from evil, but that our perfect salvation that's coming is completed at the rapture. Because salvation is not just salvation from hell, eternity in hell. Salvation is also salvation from God's judgment that's coming. We're not appointed to God's wrath. So keep that in mind. That's what we're looking for. And that's going to be it. Thank you for listening.